This is the new Tiguan. It's VW's latest mini SUV, and since it's based on the modular MQB platform, they've been able to make it longer, wider, and more spacious inside. It also looks more upmarket with premium design touches both inside and out. It's visually different to its predecessor, but it does use the latest family face that debuted on the Passat. It has some big sales shoes to fill because the old model was hugely popular, selling over 2.6 million units. We're now going to take it for a drive and tell you what it's like. So now we're aboard the new Tiguan. It's very different to its predecessor. They've made it seem more upmarket, not necessarily through the materials used, but through the design, you know. A Range Rover Evoque looks premium, not necessarily because it's made out of any specific materials, but because of the way it's made to look. The prominent grille, I mean, you should really see this grille in person. Yes, it's faux chrome plastic, but it's shaped like that of a Land Rover or a Dacia Duster, and it really gives it a luxurious yet rugged appearance. One area where this car shines more brightly than its competitors is ergonomics. VW is really, really good at this. It's probably the best manufacturer in the world when it comes to knowing where to place buttons so that you don't have to look for them. You just extend your hand and they're there. It's clear that a lot of thought went into them. I really like it that VW didn't give this car a strange newfangled shifter like all those rotary knobs or that ridiculous one that BMW does. However, this classic one with the button release and all of that is really nice and pleasant to use, and it's very intuitive. While driving it the other day and having these new digital dials, I for a few seconds thought I was actually driving an Audi. Something like the Q5 or Q7. You have lots of shoulder room and elbow room inside. Each and every place you touch, except for this this lid here, is really high quality and feels very pleasant. Even the scratchy plastics are better than most scratchy plastics, but Volkswagen could really have done a better job with this lid here for the sunglasses holder up on the dash. It just doesn't fit, and it's annoying. If you have a little bit of OCD, that's all you're going to stare at. Another area where the new Tiguan shines is in the rear legroom department. I don't remember being in a vehicle of this class where I had more rear legroom. It's really impressive. If you don't need the rear legroom, the rear bench can be slid forward individually, 60-40 split. The car features standard safety assist systems. For instance, the front assist will mitigate a crash. You know, it will brake for you, but it won't stop the car like the most advanced systems do. And it can also drive itself a little bit. Enable lane assist and take your hands off the wheel, but keep them close because the system will get frightened after a little bit and will ask you to put your hand back on the wheel. And if you don't, it will beep at you to put your hand back on the wheel. So you'll have to put your hands back on the wheel. There, it beeped. And it's still going, it's still holding the lane. The road is currently slightly curved to the right and it's still steering for me. Second beep is even louder. Okay, I'm in control. Another neat touch I noticed with this car is that you can finally both open and close the electric hatch in the back. Thank you, VW. That's a really nice touch. And it could be used for fun purposes as well, although I'm not going to go into too much detail on that. This Highline trim Tiguan with all-wheel drive and all the bells and whistles is really quite quick. It also benefits from this super snappy DSG gearbox. The engine is really torquey. Here we're in fifth gear, foot flat down, and it just takes off at 2000 RPM. And it gets more refined at around 3000 RPM. At 3000 RPM, I would actually say it sounds good. here is where you hear the engine running. The engine pulls very cleanly and has no trouble moving the car, although once you hit about 80 miles an hour, maybe, the aerodynamics really come into effect and you feel the car slow down its acceleration very noticeably. Cars like the Mazda CX-5 and Ford's Kuga or Escape are better to drive. They are more engaging, although you may not be looking for that in such a vehicle. I mean, the Mazda may be too sporty for some people who just want a relaxed driving experience, and this offers it. It's not the kind of car that would excite you, but as an all-rounder in this class, it's really good. One problem crossovers like this have is that they feel designed by a committee. It doesn't do anything particularly well. And no crossover is particularly good at anything else. It's not an off-roader, it's not an estate, it's not a hatchback, it's not a city car, it's not a proper highway cruiser, because something that's lower and sleeker will definitely be better on the highway. It's a car for people who are confused about what car they should buy, and they just buy one that has it all. And while automotive journalists may keep moaning about these characterless cars, people are buying them in the millions. So they'll just keep on selling them, because people will keep on buying them. Because they are genuinely good cars. They're just not cars to excite an enthusiast.